bugünlük yoğun bir programın ardından bugün tek bir konuşmacının yer aldığı son oturumda atölyeyi tamamlayacağız. Son konuşmacımız Lübnas Arvat. Lübnas Arvat Hindistan Haydarabad'da. Şu anda benden özünde TİSAF bir üniversitede misafir araştırmacı olarak bulunuyor. Kendisi bize kurumsal iktisat üzerinde bir sunum yapacak. Sunumunun başlığı Political Economy of Instrumentalism, Institutionalism, A Methodological Process, Feminism on Islamic Text. We have 20 minutes.
Participants of the questions and to the learned scholars who and who have been enlightening me since morning, since yesterday morning, with their beautiful notings, thought provoking notings from the speakers. I start my presentation with a few visuals. As they say, a visual speaks a thousand words. So here are some visuals, which actually depict the socio-economic status of the current world. So we see the disparities here, the disparities of being overfed and being undernourished. And we know that this is the topic of the day. Another visual, back home from our India, the top picture is a wife of a billionaire from India in her bedroom. And we see the contrast picture there. And the conventional economics talks about surplus revenue being generated from growth, which can be directed to the lower strata of the society. Here is another picture. The building that you see, Antilia, is the 27-story house of a billionaire of India, Anil Ambani. His spouse and two kids stay in the 27-story house, which is also built on a Waqf land, which the Muslims are not able to take over from there. His 700 servants stay in those quarters, and three floors are allocated for his private fleet of cars, and there is a helipad on the top of the 27-story private owned house. And we see the contrast. The biggest slum in Asia is in the financial capital of India, that is Mumbai. We see how the people are cramped there in one-room houses. Each family of 5 to 6 stay in single-room houses. This not only in Mumbai, but also in my own city of Hyderabad, where in each room we find a family of 5 to 6 staying, and in each 5 to 6 families share a single washroom. These are the ground realities. So the few of the current issues plaguing the world, as we all know, who all have gathered here know, that is poverty, inflation, education, lack of ethics, environmental degradation, wealth and income disparities, and apathy of the government and also the people towards one another, and gender and child injustice. So my question, as I've been questioning here, from trying to understand from each other, when I question, I'm actually trying to gather more information, because I'm not as learned as many of the people here. I am a learner and I will always remain a learner. So my question is, what is the Islamic economics answer to all these issues? Have we been able to come with an answer up for these issues? It's not just about riba or la riba. It is a question about the socio-economic development of the world, and Islamic economics is about well-being. Somebody just questioned me, what do you do, or what is basically what you do? I said, everything concerning the well-being of humanity. So Islam, Islam is about well-being, and it is about well-being not only of this world but also of the hereafter. That is a striking difference. So the coercive global politics, here again Islamic economics, if it is existing, does not have an answer. The conventional economics is talking about lending to a common, to a consumer, so that he can spend more. So he need not bother about how he spends, because he is going to get credit. He also has the money to spend, he also has the material to enjoy. So it is about pampering the consumer. And when Dr. Shenur had raised a point that Islamic economics are not giving them an easy model. The world is telling the common man to spend, to take the loan and to purchase and enjoy. Islamic economics is telling Israf, don't waste, exercise restraint. So it's not an easy model. It's not an easy practicable model. So where lies the defect? And also, at a time, countries with huge populations such as India and China were looked down upon by the Western countries. Today, the same Western countries, the Eurozone and the USA, are terming us, India and China, as emerging economies, because we have the populations who will consume their overproduced goods. This is the reality of today's economics. What is the answer from Islamic economics? The developed countries are practicing protectionism of their own economies, and they are against us when we exercise, or when we say that we want to protect our infant industries from onslaught. We do not want FDI. When we say, they say you are protectioning, and we are given sanctions upon it. So this is the duality in this. And also there is this transparency in all their agreements, which come in the form of trade agreements through W2O. Now I am trying to examine in my own humble way, through my topic, political economy of institutionalism, to the numerous questions, the visuals that I have raised, and to the numerous questions that I have in my mind. No, here two points that I will try to base upon in this brief talk of mine is Tawheed and Shura. Tawheed, how I used it in my brief presentation and also in my thesis, is the reduced form of unity of knowledge versus deunified knowledge. Unity of knowledge deriving from Tawheed, here to me, my interpretation, and I am understanding and also presenting before you, is a knowledge which is based on, derived from interaction of various forces, not a lopsided policy making or decision making, but a unified knowledge that carries with it various factors and has come out as a decision, and a decision which is reinforced by various factors, a decision which does not see extremes. And this can happen how? Through Shura. Shura, I understand, is a platform for bringing about the unity of knowledge versus exactly the reductionist approach being adopted by the conventional economics. Conventional economics, to my understanding, I am not writing off the conventional economics, but I am trying to understand where it has caused and how it has caused a lapse, and trying to see where we can fill the gap and produce a solution, and not just criticize and walk away. So consultative participation for me, Shura, is about having various factors, Shura being a platform for having all these various factors to come together and form a unified knowledge or a unified decision making, which does not have abstraction of factors, and which also does not have extremism in their policy. Now when we talk about a Shura and the members of the Shura, the Shari, they are basically a people with a consciousness of a different frame of mind than when we have a conventional economist sitting at the same table. So this is the point that we need to bear in mind, why their decision or their policy making is different from our policy making. We have the Akhira in our mind, we have the Jannah in our mind, where there is optimal well-being. Optimality is nowhere in this world. This is our mindset. So our decisions will naturally be very different. At this time I would digress and tell, let you all also know about, in India, we have a late Professor M.G. Bokhare, who wrote a book called Hindu Economics. Now we are talking about Islamic economics, but in India we have a professor who worked on Hindu economics. And I didn't go through the entire book, with the preface and few parts of the books, they talk about how Hindu economics is not about just the material consumption and the material well-being. There is a human is not for consumption and production. Human has a different source, very different other factors to which he wants to take care about his psychology, his emotions, his behavior, and many other things which are not taken care by the conventional economics. The Hindu economics also talked about the factors that Islamic economics is talking about. So, but when we have a Muslim economist sitting in the Shura and trying to decide upon a policy, he has all these knowledge, his consciousness is loaded with these factors known as Allah's will, known as Taqdeer, known as that the world is a fana, is going to be a fana. He's having in his mind about Yawmuddin, he's having about the fear of accountability in the Akhirah, he's having the notion, the feeling about the Jannah as the optimal place for him to live in. So these are the inbuilt consciousness with which the Shari'i is sitting in the Shura to frame a policy or an economic decision. So naturally, the decision making or the policy that will come out of the Shura will be very different. So now, how do we relate this to the, you know, Shura is being taken as an institution. Now, institution, the role of an institution is not just about the organization or not just about the substance, but it carries with it many more things. The duty of the institution will be now to carry the policy from the episteme, the policy to the grassroots level, that is to the individuals. Now, inherent breakdown of the institution we can take as the structure of the institution and the substance that it carries, that is the theme, and also the application, that is the process through which this decision making will be done on the platform of Shura, and also the evaluation of the decision making, and also how to make allow it to be sustainable. Now, features of this institution or the institutionalism is the exogenous episteme. We need to have an episteme that is absolute and at the same time which itself is irreducible but which is reducible. And we have an episteme with us that is nothing but the Quran. And in reducible terms, we just saw it is unity of knowledge. So that we take as an exogenous episteme. And now the, all the other factors which we term as endogenous and interacting with each other. Now endogeneity, even now in this, when we say all other variables, all other factors are endogenous, we mean that even ethics is endogenous in this. We cannot make a technology which is ethics neutral. We cannot make any policy, any educational system, anything telling that it is neutral to ethics. Presence of an institution for discourse. Discourse means a consultative participation of all the factors. Now mutual consultation with consciousness. We just saw how a conscious Muslim economist who is conscious of various other things which are built into psychology, his decision making is going to be very different from a conventional economist. Now, epistemic knowledge building under a recursive evolutionary learning process. Now, this learning process is never going to be optimal. The decision making is always going to be in a learning process which will always revisit the episteme which is external to the entire learning process and but which is unchangeable. And we institutionalize this process at various organizational levels. Inter and intrasystemic linkages. Recognizing that each and every factor of the world systems is interacting with each other and not bifurcating them into watertight compartments and allowing them to interact, which is the natural organic way that the systems are functioning. And now we also, in this institutional process, we also simulate and see how the well-being is worked upon through this policy decision. This is a brief figure, I included because it's there in my paper as well. This is just a small figurative illustration of how in the Shura we derive the knowledge, and in the second part of it, a rectangular part of it, we see the various variables, various factors in this world which are interacting, highly complexly interacting with each other but are at the same time cohesive and very unified. Now after the Shura deduced Tawhidi epistemic knowledge is now interacting with the variables, then the output is now, it is the result is that the factors are embedded with this knowledge, and then we simulate or test the well-being of that, and it is in an iterative or recursive process which ensures the sustainability. So briefly, I want to put before you all how we can see this implementation in the practical world. We have had the UN poverty conference. We have also had the UN Copenhagen climate change conference. We have many such conferences. But I try to highlight through my other articles also, how because of lack of participation of various other factors, the decision that was the decision or the policy that came out of those conferences was a lopsided policy. Because, for example, one thing I praise before you all, for your comments and also for your feedback is, the UN Poverty Conference, I simulated that as UN Poverty Shura Conference. The UN Poverty Conference did not take into consideration many of the factors that I have highlighted there. For poverty, I have highlighted here that military attacks have also caused poverty. We all sitting here know that definitely military attacks from USA and also from the NATO and everybody has brought poverty to millions of people with the attack of 3 to 4 single nations. But in the UN Poverty Conference, which was conducted just 1 year back, they never considered military attacks as a factor affecting poverty, did they? They did not. Then how can the policy that is coming out of this conference be effective for the ground reality? When you have not considered a factor which has caused the poverty, caused the issue, then how can the policy come from there which will actually resolve the issue? So that is a de-unified knowledge. I am trying to understand this with you all. It cannot be a unified knowledge because the factor that has caused the issue named poverty was not reckoned to bring out a policy. If military attacks have not been considered, the debt interest, numerous African countries have come out with their statistics as to how much of debt they have been paying on the aid that they take from the World Bank and the IMF. Is that not the cause of poverty? But the UN Poverty Conference did not reckon this as a factor. Similarly, ethics. Similarly, natural calamities. And also displacement due to industries. Numerous lands in India also. In India and even in China. The Great Gorges Dam in the China and even in India. To construct various industrial corridors, the land is just taken away from the poor and the tribals in India. The tribals are resisting because they lose the ownership of the land, they lose their sustainable livelihood and they are left with not even a place to live or not even a place of identity for years together. The livelihood that is promised by the government may come, may not come and it does not also come at some times. Then in the name of industry, the displacement industries, have we not caused poverty? But in the UN Poverty Conference, all these factors are not taken into consideration. Hence, I consider that as a de-unified knowledge. It is not a unified knowledge because the episteme of unity of knowledge, which emphasizes that all the factors which have caused the issue have to be taken into, has not been followed. So here I am trying to put it in a functional form. How P, which is poverty, is a function of so many other factors, all the factors that I have shown in this particular figure. I have just tried to put it in a iterative functional form, how each factor is causing and being caused by various other factors. Now, another agricultural consultative participative institution, which I have again framed, and at a place when I told that in India, for example, it may be happening in various other countries also, I heard of with my limited knowledge, that in India basically what is happening is the farmers are just committing suicide because they are in debt and because they have not got a proper produce, proper agricultural produce. Even if you have heard of Kingfisher Airlines, which is from India, and the billionaire owner of Kingfisher Airlines is Vijay Mallya, who is also a liquor baron. He is into loans up to 10,000 crores. Please follow me. Please, so that you can answer my questions. He is a liquor baron with more than 10,000 crores of loans led by a consortium of banks in India. He did not commit suicide. His Kingfisher airline is down. All the banks are demanding, calling back their loans from him. His airline license has been cancelled. He did not commit suicide. He is dining and enjoying in the Burj Dubai. From there, he is tweeting to his people, in India, I am in the 101 floor. I am enjoying my lunch. How are you? A journalist captured this tweet. Okay, he is in debt of 10,000 crores and he has still not committed suicide. He is happy. But an Indian farmer in my place who is having a debt of 1 lakh or maybe less than 1 lakh commits suicide. This is the reality. He's one with so much of loans, he is not committing. And these, my friends, my agriculturists, they are committing suicide with such powerless loans. So when I said that agriculturists should be having the agriculture participating institution at each village and block level, and they should have a counselor or a psychiatrist there to counsel them, that at no cost should they end their life. They should be having the personality development courses which will bring their confidence and everything back. The capitalists disagreed with me. The IT professionals disagreed with me. The IT professionals, the booming software industry can have a personality development course to boost their confidence. But the hardworking agriculturists, when I said that they too should have a personality development course to build their confidence so that they can be more productive in their agriculture, so that they can boost the economy, I was disagreed with. I was actually laughed at. Whereas I say it is a de-unified knowledge, because a factor such as integrated counseling centers, they did not have the agricultural literacy with them. They do not have the locale specific low cost and effective agricultural gadgets with them. When all these are not given to them properly, not even streamlined low cost finance is given to them, nothing is given to them, how do we expect them to boost the economy? How do we expect them to survive? So I say that when we don't take all the factors together into a decision making, it creates a de-unified knowledge. And this is my sort of a recommendation from as a forum of Islamic economics, that we can counter the conventional economics telling that you are not premising on unity of knowledge. Unity of knowledge means bringing together all the factors that actually affect a particular issue, and hence you people are having a de-unified knowledge. And to overcome the de-unified knowledge, we have necessarily to bring in all the factors onto the table, whether it is a United Nations or whether it's a W2 conference or anything else, or whether it is a G20 conference. We can, as Islamic economists, as Muslim economists, place before them without the terminology of either the Islam or the Quran. But we achieve what we want. I'm ending up my presentation maybe before time, I don't know. But I want to put forth before you this wonderful quote. I shall pass through this world but once. Any good therefore that I can do, or any kindness that I can show to any human being, let me do it now. Let me not defer or neglect it, for I shall not pass this way again. This is not from the Quran. I love this quote. I quote it at many places. It is by Stephen Grillett, whom I don't even know. But for me, the words show a lot. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Tübla Hanım'a çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Fıkhi dil müzakeresini yapmak üzere İlginç Teknik Üniversitesi'nden Doçent Doktor Tamer Çetin Bey'i
çağırdık. Öncelikle ben de İLEM'e ve Lütfi Hocam'a teşekkür ediyorum bu etkinlik için. Çalışmayı önce neden söz ettiğinden galiba kalkmıyor. Çalışmayı önce neden söz ettiğinden bahsederek, sonra da söz ettiklerinin bizim konvansiyonel iktisat içerisindeki yerinin ne olduğundan söz ederek kısaca özetlemeye çalışacağım. Bir kere bana gelen versiyonda modellemiş olduğu bu yapıyı işte Birleşmiş Milletler Konferansı'yla ilişkilendirmediğini gördüm. Bunu biraz genişletmiş bu anlamda. Çalışma konvansiyonel iktisadın İslami kaygılar barındırmadığını, dolayısıyla refah gibi, mutluluk gibi temel sorunlarla çok ilgilenmediğini, bu ilginin de işte etiği dışsal bir faktör olarak kabul ederek yapmaya çalıştığını belirlediğini söylüyor. Bu anlamda konvansiyonel iktisadın temel sorunlarının ya da eksikliklerinin neler olduğunu İki başlık altında toplayabiliriz. Birincisi yazara göre konvansiyonel iktisat bu fayda ve refah sorununu çözme konusunda karmaşık bir literatüre sahip. Yani bir fikir birliği ortaya çıkmıyor. İkincisi bu birinci sorunla bağlantılı olarak tek bir bilgi üretilemiyor. Bu tek birliğinin yok, tek bir bilginin üretilememesi sorunundan dolayı da birinci yeni noktada bir politika yapma sürecine gidilemediğini, konvansiyonel iktisadın bu anlamda sorumlu olduğunu ifade ediyor. Bunun için öneri olarak İslam iktisadı içerisindeki kurumsal yapının kullanılabileceğini, bu kurumsal yapı içerisinden tevhid inancı üzerinden bir tek bilgiye ulaşılabilecek kurumsal bir yapı tesis edilebileceğini ve böylelikle işte şura denilen mekanizma içerisinde etkin politika yapma süreçleri sonucunda etkin bir politikaya erişilebileceği ifade ediliyor. Bunun için yazar bir model öneriyor. Bu modelde şuranın almış olduğu kararın Tata'nın doğru epistemik bilgi olacağını, bunun içinde işte İslam'ın zekat gibi ya da işte emri bil maruf nehyi anil münker gibi temel kurumsal yapılarından etkilenerek birinci en iyi bilgiye ulaşabileceğini ifade ediyor. Eğer şura bu Tata'yı, doğru bilgiyi bu karar alma süreçlerinde gerçekten üretebilirse, böylelikle almış olduğu kararlar üzerinden ilgililer üzerinde refah düzeyini arttırabileceğini ifade ediyor. Bunun için dünya sistemi içerisinde işte kendisinin de göstermiş olduğu gibi bu X1'den X3'e kadar, Y1'den Y3'e kadar dünya içerisindeki farklı değişkenlerin birbirleriyle dinamik etkileşimlerinin mutlaka bu şura kararından etkilendiğini ifade ediyor. Eğer diyor ki bu dünya içerisindeki farklı sistemlerde yer alan X ve Y gibi değişkenlerin şimdi İslami kurumsal yapıdan etkilenirse, yani bunların hepsi Tata'ya bağımlı hale gelirse, bu durumda welfare'ında, yani refah düzeyinde konvansiyonel iktisadında olamayacak şekilde refah düzeyini arttırmaya yönelik bir sonuca ulaşabileceğini ifade ediyor. Bu bağlamda makalenin kurumsal iktisatla ilişkisi, şura, zekat ve tevhid gibi kurumların refahı etkileyebileceğiyle ilişkilendirilerek, işte İslami bir perspektifin kurumsal iktisatla ilişkisi kurulmaya, bir link kurulmaya çalışılmış. Bu anlamda evet, yani kurumsal iktisat üzerinden böyle bir okuma yapılabilir. Ama bu okuma yine de normatif kalıyor. Normatif kaldığını zaten yazar kendisi makalede söylüyor. Bu herhangi bir sorun teşkil etmeyebilir ama zaten konvansiyonel iktisadın da normatif olduğu, olabildiğince ütopik olduğu, olabildiğince gerçek dünya sorunlarına ilişmediği yönündeki eleştirisi böylelikle bu makale içinde geçerli hale gelmiş oluyor diye düşünüyorum. Bir diğer yandan mesela bu kurumsal ilişki kurulacaksa, eğer kurumsal ilişki içerisinde bu X ve Y değişkenlerin Tata üzerindeki etkisinde mesela şuranın çok geniş tabanlı, olabildiğince geniş kitlelere yayılan bir karar alma süreci olduğundan söz ediliyor. Ve bu sürecin de şeffaflığı ve hesap verebilirliği getireceği söyleniyor ama gerçek dünyada biz biliyoruz ki aslında bu kadar geniş tabanlı karar alma süreçleri mutlaka asimetrik enformasyon gibi, mutlaka yüksek pozitif işlem maliyetleri gibi bir takım başka sorunlar da ihtiva ediyor. Acaba bu sorunlar modele dahil edilip de bunun üzerinden refah düzeyi nasıl etkilenebilir sorusuna bir cevap vermek mümkün olabilir mi? Eğer böyle olursa benim kanımca model daha ayakları yere basan bir tabana oturmuş olur. Evet, bunun dışında söyleyeceğim başka bir şey yok. Teşekkür ederim.
Bugün hem konuşmacımız hem müzakerecimiz son oturumun herhalde vermiş olduğu havayla zamanı gayet ekonomik kullanıyorlar. Aynı şeyi inşallah yorumculardan ve sorulardan da bekliyoruz. Şimdi 20 dakika yorum, eleştiri, öneri ve sorular için ayrılmış olacağız. Aslında diğer oturumlarda olduğu gibi uzmanla 5-6 dakikalık bir oturum vereceğiz.
So,
çalışıyor. Mikrofonu açabilir misiniz?
Çalışıyor.
Açık.
Şu an çalışıyor mikrofon. Çalışıyor. Thank you for nice presentation of some very important concepts. What I wanted to say was that It is definitely true that in every area, Islam offers us new ways of thinking and new ways of organizing both economic systems and the theory of economic systems. Unfortunately, as was forecast in the hadith, that Islam came as a stranger and will become a stranger. So, it is true that the teachings of Islam are now not known to the Muslims. So, for example, we are talking about Shura. But what exactly is Shura? Very few people know what the rules are and how it is to be done. And when it is mentioned that we should use this, people say, oh, it's not practical anymore. This was possible only in a very small society. Now the society is big, so we must use some modern systems. Because we lack the knowledge of what the Quran has said. Allah Ta'ala said, Amrahum Shura Bainam. So Allah Ta'ala has given us a system. But we don't know what that system is. So now, Muslims are saying that democracy is the right system. Because the West says that this is so. And then they also try to find evidence for democracy from the Quran and Hadith. Because if it is the best, then Islam is automatically the best, so it must support this. And they forget that Islam has actually a superior system, because we don't know it. It is the same thing in economics and in all other things. But the problem is that with this paper and similar efforts, that we need to go back to the original teachings. We don't really need to develop new methodology. We don't have to think things from scratch. It is already there. We have to study our traditions, our hadith and the Quran, and to derive the principles from those sources. We cannot derive it from mathematics, and we cannot derive it from calculus, and we cannot derive it from network theory, and we cannot derive it from social capital theory. So the material is there, but nobody is looking at it. That's all.
Teşekkür ederiz. O zaman başka söz isteyen? Evet. Sanırım benim gibi herkes yok. Yes. You may answer the questions and the comments.
Thank you, Professor Zaman, for your encouragement in the presentation. Now, regarding Shura, there is a small example I want to quote you all. Back home in Hyderabad, a professor from the University of Columbia, USA, had come to address us exactly on the topic of democracy. And when he told about, when he is speaking from a democratic USA point of view, not about the Shura. But the why I attended us, because I know that when Muslims are asked of, there is no democracy in Islam, everybody is bringing up, as professor suggested, the name of Shura. Oh no, no, we have it, we have Shura. We have become so dependent. If somebody attacks us, we have, no, no, we have it, we have Shura. We have become like that. No, democracy, in my opinion, is being exported by the Occident or by the America to the entire world. He's exporting it from there, as if democracy is the optimal and the ultimate solution and the proper most representation to be given for policy making. But is democracy flawless? This professor from Columbia raised a question in that lecture that day. He was asking, how does even minority community be represented in the parliament? But that is not the question of democracy. Democracy is a demographic demarcation, a geographical demarcation, and a representative is selected from that particular geographic demarcation. That is all about democracy. It is not a representative of communities. It is not a representative of various factors that are interacting. It is not a representation of various factors of interest. It is a demographic and geographic demarcational representation. So, such a flawless democracy is being exported and imposed upon the whole world. Dictatorships are being toppled down in the name of this flawed democracy and that is being imposed there. So I just wanted to highlight this point that Shura has inherent, as Professor Spadler, it has inherent, and if we make Shura as the platform and show the episteme of unity of knowledge and tell that this democracy is flawed, here the Shura, there is a presentation of every factor, and herein we have decisions which are sense abstraction and which are or sense extremism in decision making. So this is how I feel that Islamic or Muslim economists should suggest an alternative to the world. And as I was discussing with Professor Fahim, that if we, and also through my questions that I raised, why Muslim economists with so much of knowledge and so many scholarly presentations, why with so much of learned knowledge, why aren't we able to bring this policy down to the grassroots? It is because we do not have a strong political body that is willing to take this and implement and show it. Why is democracy being exported and imposed? Because of the power of the Occident. Because the politics there, they want the democracy to survive, and they are also imposing it through their military power. Whereas the governments with Muslim governments are not willing to accept the learned scholars' proposals. Which Muslim government out of the 53 to 60 or 70 Muslim countries are ready to accept Shura and ready to implement it in the spirit of it? The Shura of Saudi Arabia is nominated by the King Abdullah. The Shura of Afghanistan is to a very nominal level. It is again nominated. The Shura of Tehran is not an elected body. Now the only body, only Shura in the world which is a little bit representative, Sultanate of Oman. That's it. And that is also a demographic representation again. It is not an interaction of the factors to develop the proper policy body or knowledge that is to be disseminated again and look into the socio-economic development. And that too, Muslims have a double responsibility. The conventional economics, even if it is about well-being, the Muslim economist's well-being is not limited to the world. We are taking care of the well-being of this world and the hereafter. And we are affected, our psychology is reinforced by various Quranic factors that will make our decision making itself different. So it is because of non-imposition from the political bodies or the Muslim governments that we do not see that in the reality today. And a very interesting point is, in India, we are having inflation, even double digit inflation we had for the just past year also. And whereas the latest news that is the day I came in Turkey, probably the day before, is that in Japan, the consumer prices are fallen down so badly, the price level has gone down so badly that the policy makers are trying to think of policies that can stoke inflation. Look at the contrary things that are happening in the world. Whereas in India and other countries, developing countries, we are struggling to control inflation. The common man in India does not have the proper fruit or the vegetable, or the things are just going beyond his reach. Whereas in Japan, the prices have fallen so down that the government wants to stoke inflation, that is, it wants to create inflation there. Here we want to control inflation. So these are some extreme decisions. This is all coming because there is no unified knowledge and no proper policy making. I want to come to the discussants. I don't know his name.
Tamir.
I want to come to Brother Tamir's point. He was suggesting that the Shura body, was it you? So he was suggesting that what a little I could follow from is, he expressed his apprehensions that there could be asymmetric information and also there could be high costs out of this decision making. We all know the number of conferences that are going each day in the entire world. Not only just academic conferences, but various policy level conferences that are going on. Even if a single conference adopts this methodology that no, we will have unified knowledge premised on the unity of knowledge, then it, first of all, it can never lead to asymmetric info, because that is the exact thing that we are trying to overcome. We are trying to overcome the reductionism being adopted by the conventional methodology, and we are trying to bring in inclusivity. They speak about inclusivity, but inclusivity demands that we include all the factors. But the factors themselves are not included. How can we get an inclusive decision? So we are trying to very much address the inclusivity factor, and that is the asymmetric information factor. And high costs, as I'm repeating the same thing, we can guess the immense costs that are going into the conferences across the globe in a single day. Every minute there are conferences somewhere or the other across the globe going on. But even if a single conference thinks about in these terms, not that it came from Islam, not that it came from Hinduism, but as something that is necessary for the humanity, it will actually go into reducing the costs. That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Kıymetli katılımcılar, sunumlarıma bir kez daha teşekkür ediyorum. Ayrıca sizlere de çok teşekkür ediyorum. Bu konferansı sabırla gün boyunca büyük bir dikkat sarf ederek dinlediniz. Kanaatinizce bu konferansı organize ederken yola çıkmış olduğumuz amaca büyük oranda yaklaşmış bulunuyoruz. İstanbul İktisadı'nın sadece teknik bir mesele olmadığını, aynı zamanda bir dünya görüşünün, bir bakış açısının, bir felsefenin yansıması olduğunu ve bir felsefeye sahip olduğunu, bir arka plana sahip olduğunu tartışmak istemiştik. Bu konferansın bundan sonraki çalışmalara bir zemin teşkil etmesini ve bizim de umduğumuz üzere devamının gelerek daha verimli, daha derinlikli, daha uzun erimli çalışmaları ortaya çıkartmasını temenni ediyoruz. Ben bir kez daha farklı ülkelerden çok kıymetli vakitlerini ayırarak, çok kıymetli bilgilerini bizlerle paylaşmak üzere gelen tebliğ sahiplerine ve yine çok kıymetli vakitlerini ayırarak tebliğleri müzakere eden müzakerecilerimize, ayrıca davetimize yanıt vererek bu toplantıya icabet eden İslam İktisadı ile ilgili akademik ilgisi olan, entelektüel ilgisi olan değerli katılımcılara çok teşekkür ediyorum. İnşallah bu çalışmalar hayırlara vesile olur. İnşallah daha adil bir dünyanın kurulması için bir nebze de olsun katkısı olur bu çalışmalar. Hepinize bir kez daha çok teşekkür ediyorum. Hayırlı akşamlar.